Welcome to the first episode of Innovation Matters, a podcast organized by the Netherlands Innovation Network. This episode will be talking about antimicrobial resistance and is broadcasted from Shanghai, China. Today we cover the topic of antimicrobial resistance, also called AMR. Antimicrobial resistance happens when microorganisms, such as bacteria, change when they are exposed to antimicrobial drugs, such as antibiotics. This makes the infections they cause harder to treat or even untreatable. Bacteria are becoming increasingly resistant to many antibiotics, and too few new antibiotics are being developed to combat them. The World Health Organization rebukes this lack of innovation when it comes to the antibiotic pipeline. We will talk more about how the economic model is failing for developing new antibiotics. In Europe, approximately 25,000 people die every year because of drug-resistant infections. It is estimated that AMR will kill an extra 10 million people globally by 2050. Without new antibiotics, it will be increasingly difficult to effectively treat infections. And procedures such as organ transplantation, cancer chemotherapy, or common surgical operations such as hip or knee replacement will carry an increased risk of untreatable infection. The antibiotic pipeline needs to be revitalized by stimulating innovation and driving sustainable use at the same time. Today, I have two guests who are both experts on the topic, tackling the issue from the Netherlands and China, respectively. Our next episode will also be dedicated to this topic. Then we will talk with researchers who all combat AMR from a different perspective. For today, my first guest is Dr. Maarten van Dongen, who founded an online platform targeting professionals from several fields who are all dealing with AMR. Welcome, Dr. Maarten van Dongen. Could you please briefly introduce yourself?
My name is Maarten van Dongen. I am a medical and molecular microbiologist. And after my study at the University of Groningen in the Netherlands, I did my PhD at Amsterdam University in biochemistry. I subsequently started working in the pharmaceutical industry and later on in the biopharmaceutical industry in several European countries. And after that, I did a lot of consulting work in the domain of innovation and life sciences.
Maarten started focusing on AMR after being involved in a number of projects on the topic for several Dutch ministries. He discovered that a variety of sectors are involved in causing antimicrobial resistance, but that the professionals within these sectors are not always connected adequately. This often causes them to be uninformed, as they tend to only focus on curbing the problem within their field. In order to improve intersectoral collaboration, he founded AMR Insights, a global information platform on AMR.
I took the initiative in 2017 to involve 12 Dutch organizations, including public organizations, but also private organizations, to very seriously investigate the feasibility of a novel information platform entirely focused on antimicrobial resistance. So together with these 12 organizations, we took a few months to investigate if it would be feasible to set up an international information platform to inform professionals on antimicrobial resistance. And after a few months of this feasibility investigations, we jointly concluded that there was indeed a serious market for a global information platform. And we took the initiative to initiate AMR Insights. So that was actually the beginning of a very inspiring journey, because having this information platform was only the very beginning of a global initiative focusing on curbing antimicrobial resistance.
I checked the platform, and even though it started only 3 years ago, it has already transformed to the most comprehensive platform on AMR globally. The unique feature of the platform is that it's the only one that targets all sectors involved in the AMR problem. You say 6 major sectors are responsible. Can you tell me which ones?
Many people think that this is only an issue for hospitals and maybe for doctors, but in fact, we see that six different sectors are heavily involved and should also be clearly addressed when you talk about informing professionals. And one is the healthcare sector, obviously, with the medical doctors, nurses, infection prevention specialists. So the whole human healthcare sector, which is obviously a very important sector. The second very important sector is the sector of animals, with veterinarians, but also with the cattle farmers. In this sector also, many professionals are involved, including what I mentioned, the veterinarians, who should be aware of the development, or should be aware of the threat of antimicrobial resistance. The third important sector is the agri-food sector. I mean, this is something which many people do not realize, but also in the food sector, many antimicrobials, antibiotics are being used. So resistance is also a critical issue in this sector. And this applies, for instance, to the dairy sector, the milk and the milk products, but also to the meat sector. Then we have the sector of the what we call surveillance professionals. I think of national and international authorities, but also NGOs and organizations like WHO. Also, these people are very much involved in antimicrobial resistance, but obviously do need very different information than, for instance, veterinarians. Then we have the sector of the innovators, and I think of academia, universities, research institute, but also academic medical centers, and also certainly the research and development organizations of big pharma companies, small biotech companies, startups, diagnostics companies. Also, these organizations are dealing with antimicrobial resistance, but in an entirely different way compared to, for instance, doctors or veterinarians. So also these professionals need a different type of information. And then last but not least, we have the environmental sector. Think of water treatment plants, but also drinking water companies. I mean, these organizations are also dealing with antibiotics in wastewater systems, antibiotics in the effluents of hospitals. And this is adds to the threat of AMR, of antimicrobial resistance. And so also the professionals working in this sector should be informed and should be involved.
So the platform collects all information on AMR, then selects all relevant materials for the specific sectors involved, and then redistributes this information, right?
That's correct.
If you read about the topic, you'll notice right away that the main shortfall is data collection. Data is scattered among several sectors, research institutes, but also pharmaceutical companies that decided to discontinue their research activities, startups that have come bankrupt, etc. And this all makes it unnecessarily complex to find solutions. So improved data collection and management is crucial, and in my opinion, one of the strategies to curb AMR. But what other strategies should be followed as well?
Well, I fully agree with what you're saying, that data are of utmost importance. Data are, play an increasing important role when talking about solving AMR, solving antimicrobial resistance. Basically, we as AMR Insights see five different strategies, five key strategies to curb and to fight antimicrobial resistance. And I will just briefly explain these key strategies. The first and by far most important strategy is to actually prevent infectious diseases. Because if you prevent people from becoming sick, and also animals from becoming sick, then these people and these animals do not need antimicrobials, do not need antibiotics. And this means that also there's no risk that you get resistant bacteria, which are not sensitive anymore to antibiotics. Prevention, better prevention can be obtained, for instance, through better hygiene measures, including washing your hands more frequently, but also, for instance, by vaccination, by having proper vaccination strategies such that people simply do not become sick.
So strategy number one is infection prevention, which is very obvious. Personal hygiene is key here. I think because of COVID, there is more awareness of the importance of it. So if we could sustain the higher level of personal hygiene collectively, this would actually contribute to curbing AMR.
Yeah, I fully agree. Right. I fully agree. Yeah.
So strategy number two.
Well, the strategy number two is to have a better antibiotic stewardship. And I will explain what this means. It is very important that the medical doctors, but also the veterinarians who do prescribe antibiotics and other antimicrobial products, that they do this, that they do so in a very careful way, and that there is no irrational use of antimicrobials, both by the medical doctors and by the veterinarians. It seems, or there is evidence that in daily practice, antibiotics are being prescribed in many cases without proper testing, and this should be prevented to the extent possible. In addition, there is also, and this is related to antibiotic stewardship, there is also a lot of unwanted release of antibiotics and other antimicrobials in wastewater streams and effluents from hospitals and also in production plants. So this is also a way through which antimicrobials come into the environment and also will result in antimicrobial resistance. So actually, antibiotic stewardship has two sides of the coin. One is to have a better prescription, a better and rational prescription of antibiotics to patients and to animals. And second, that there is a better control of the release of antibiotics in wastewater streams and effluents of hospitals and in production plants throughout the world.
You say a lot of the antibiotics are prescribed without testing. Do you mean the need to test whether or not an infection is caused by a bacteria or a virus? Or are there also additional tests that should be conducted?
That is one of the three important aspects of a better testing. And in fact, the better testing, improved diagnostics, is in fact also the third key strategy to curb antimicrobial resistance. It has, what I just said, three major aspects. One is to test for, is this patient having a bacterial infection, or does the patient have a viral infection? Because many, even medical doctors, do not realize that antibiotics do not work against viruses. So it is of crucial importance that it is known if the patient does have a bacterial or a viral infection. And that means sometimes that you need to test. The second thing is, if you know that it is a bacterial infection, it is of importance to know what bacteria is causing the infection, because not all antibiotics do work against all bacteria. So you need to know what bacteria is causing the infection. And thirdly, and that's of increasing importance, it should be known also to what antibiotics the bacteria is already resistant. And bacteria can be sensitive to all available antibiotics, but they can also be and become resistant to one antibiotic, but also to two or three or even more, or even to all commercially available antibiotics. So the prescribing doctor or the prescribing veterinarian should in fact know before prescribing the antibiotic to what antibiotics the bacteria which is causing the infectious disease is already resistant, because then he knows what antibiotics to prescribe. So improved diagnostics is the third and important pillar in the global curbing of AMR.
So improved diagnostics, which is strategy number three, requires testing. With testing, you mean sampling the bacteria that is causing the infection, so a more informed decision on how to treat the infection can be made, right?
Yeah. And that has two aspects. One is identification of the bacterium, and two, identification, testing, or if the bacterium is susceptible, sensitive, or already resistant to the antibiotic to be prescribed.
So what about research and development for those tests? Because as far as I know, when I go to see my family doctor for an infection, I simply get antibiotics without any testing in advance. Are there accurate, fast, and cheap tests out there or being developed? And also, what kind of technologies, like artificial intelligence, for example, could play a role in this development?
A lot is going on where it comes to developing novel antibiotics. Many novel type of diagnostics are being developed by in academia, but also by many startups and small and medium sized enterprises around the globe. And that's the good news, obviously. Many entirely different technologies are being tested and applied in these diagnostic tests. I must say already that it is not an easy task for these companies also to validate these technologies, because it is quite difficult for them to enter these tests in existing healthcare centers and hospitals. To test these novel diagnostics, because obviously validation is of great importance. So that's in daily practice quite a challenge for these companies. But coming back to your question, a lot is going on with different technologies, and artificial intelligence is one of the upcoming and promising technologies when it comes to developing novel diagnostic tests. And for instance, artificial intelligence can be used to better predict drug resistance. It can also be used to better predict the minimum inhibitory values for the antibiotics, but also to identify biomarkers and identify resistant genes in the bacteria, but also for gene prospecting. And having said this, you can already conclude that because artificial intelligence is so broadly applicable already only within this small domain of diagnostic testing, that it is obvious that we need a sort of further streamlining of the use of artificial intelligence in order to avoid that we will have many different type of applications, because ultimately we need to integrate data, we need to come to some unity in thinking where it comes to artificial intelligence.
Still, most AI solutions are premature. They're in a premature state. Most of the new technologies are also only applied in the academia or at startup companies, but they're not yet utilized at a large scale. In our next episode, we will go more in depth as we talk to several researchers in the field who are all tackling the issue with different tools and from a different angle. We'll talk about understanding and predicting evolution paths of bacteria, the importance of big data collection and artificial intelligence. We'll also talk about how technologies are used to develop new antibiotics and alternative treatments, and on how we could inhibit the resistance mechanism of bacteria. You will find the second episode to be released on this platform 2 weeks after the publication date of this episode. I know that AMR Insights, your platform, also underlines the importance of applying new technologies. On the website, I read that last year, AMR Insights hosted a matchmaking symposium on, quote, upcoming data technologies to corner AMR. Next to artificial intelligence, other technologies were mentioned as well, like blockchain technology and Internet of Things. I read about the topics discussed back then, and there are many promising developments out there. And if you think about it, there must be a great potential when these technologies would be unified. So we have these advanced insights already. We have improved tests. We could already prescribe medication much more efficiently. But for some reason, it's hard to get these technologies to use on a large scale. Apparently, these often startup companies face obstacles bringing their product to the market. So what are the obstacles these companies face?
Well, they face a number of obstacles to start with, and then you are also talking about the value chain of novel diagnostics. Most ideas for novel diagnostics arise from basic research at universities. And this is obviously often subsidized or funded research, which is great. Then novel ideas come up, but well, to further develop the ideas to concrete applications, and this means in practice to, well, pilot test systems. And once you have these, and when these startup companies can show that these tests may be effective and may be applicable, then these tests need to be well, tested at a large scale. Just then more money, more funding is needed for these large scale testings. And obviously, these test systems need also to be tested in real life, in hospitals and healthcare settings. I think that is by far the biggest hurdle, because first of all, many different tests are being developed. I mean, there's a whole broad scala of novel tests being developed. That obviously is good news. But the problem is that all these tests need to be validated, and hospitals are not really set up to provide testing possibilities for novel tests. And implementing a novel test system means also that you need to change the logistics, and so you need the input and the help of all the professionals involved, including the doctors, and they may need to deliver the blood samples in different test tubes, as an example. The logistics may be different, the equipment needs to be changed, the data processing needs to be changed, the data integration needs to be changed. So it is quite challenging to actually test and validate these diagnostic tests in hospitals. And it is obviously needed to ultimately prove that these novel diagnostic tests are valid and can indeed be commercialized at a large scale and implemented at the global scale.
So the issue mainly concerns product validation and the lack of access to the infrastructure you need for clinical testing. But up to now, we were talking about companies working on products to improve diagnostics, so working on tests. But what about companies researching new antibiotics or alternative treatments? Do they face similar issues? Because what these companies try to develop is a solution for a severely pressing issue that the whole world is facing. If they would be successful in finding a new drug or alternative, the demand for their product would be insatiable. And it's hard to believe that they would also suffer from similar issues due to their small scale.
In fact, you are now touching upon the fourth key strategy, which is needed to curb antimicrobial resistance, and that's the need for novel antibiotics and other novel antimicrobials. To briefly elaborate on that first, it is known that, as said, that many bacteria around the globe are already resistant to existing commercially available antibiotics. So there is a desperate need for novel antibiotics and other antimicrobial products. And one would indeed say, like you already mentioned, that if there is such an enormous need for novel antibiotics and other antimicrobial products, then it would be a very lucrative business to develop these and commercialize these. But in daily practice, in reality, it is extremely challenging to start a company focusing on research and development of novel antibiotics and other antimicrobial products, and not only to develop these products, but ultimately especially to commercialize these novel antibiotics. And this was also for AMR Insights the reason to organize a webinar a few weeks ago, where we invited Dr. Ryan Search, as he was the co-founder of a United States company called Akeoken. This startup company was able to research and develop one, and later at later stage even more antibiotics, and also commercialize antibiotics. But despite having a antibiotic on the market, this company went bankrupt after a short period of time. So we invited this co-founder, Dr. Ryan Search, to explain in this webinar why this company with a promising antibiotic nevertheless went bankrupt.
And so really the failures we're seeing with the public companies, again, all my opinions, not the opinions of the entities I've represented in the past, is that this has always been the case. We're just seeing it laid to bear in the public markets because the small companies don't have the revenue from their other products to basically cover up this giant hole we're about to talk about.
This was Ryan Search, founder of the antibiotic development startup Akeogen. He explains during a webinar on AMR Insights why it's nearly impossible for a startup to develop a new drug.
And so it's not a particularly complicated equation. So basically, our argument is the cost to do business is much greater than the price you can charge for your product times the amount of times it gets used. That's just the fact at every launch. The fixed cost to do business, we're really trying to be reductionist and get to core things that are really hard to argue with. Because, of course, you can blow this away and add all kinds of bells and whistles and have a huge team. We're really trying to get to the core issues in the business that are there right as you're approved. The limits on pricing, there's lots of articles on that and where we're sort of stuck there. And then the limited number of patients, we're trying to get there before the problem is cataclysmically bad, but the math doesn't work at that point in time. And then, of course, hopefully when we finally fix this someday, the issue that, you know, the most rare things, there's no mechanism to get better reimbursement for something super rare. So today, an oral drug for ESBL UTI is more economically valuable than an IV drug for Acinetobacter. It just is. So how do we fix these problems? And they're all driven by number of patients and price.
The development of a new antibiotic takes often more than 10 years and can cost more than $1 billion. And after investing the time and money, there is no certainty your product will turn out to be a successful antibiotic. It is a costly, risky, and lengthy process. And even if your successful product reaches the market, there is another problem.
New antibiotics which have come on the market should preferably be kept on the shelf to the extent possible, because if we would allow these novel antibiotics to be distributed to the extent possible, then we would see that also for these new antibiotics, many bacteria would become resistant on their turn. So we prefer to keep these novel antibiotics reserved for already, well, the very worst cases where patients will obviously almost, nearly die. And then there's a sort of, last resort antibiotics.
This very low return on investment of the development of new antibiotics is probably the reason why big pharmaceutical companies hardly conduct any research in this field.
Exactly.
So what about other alternative treatments when all antibiotics fail? Phage therapy could be a solution. Phages are viruses that solidly kill and selectively target bacteria. But there are other alternatives as well, is that right?
That's right. What you're saying is that, alternative antimicrobial strategies is in effect the fifth key strategy to curb antimicrobial resistance. It's of key importance. And fortunately, many new technologies and many new products do arise, which are a very promising alternative to the use of antibiotics, especially also because it seems that to many of these alternative strategies, there is no antibiotic, there is no resistance coming up. You're mentioning phage therapy as one of the examples of alternative antimicrobial strategies. And from my perspective, phage therapy is an undervalued alternative to antibiotics. And phages are viruses. And these phages have the advantage, so to say, that they do attack bacteria whilst not attacking human cells. So they are not dangerous in principle for humans or for animals when you apply to animals. So they can be used to treat humans with bacterial infections because these phages do attack the bacteria whilst leaving the human body, the human cells, unattacked.
Are there any other important technological developments at the moment?
Yeah, what I also would like to stress is the use of novel nanomaterials and other materials which can be used, which have an antimicrobial function. And as an example, you have novel materials which can be used, for instance, in hip replacement therapies, but also in bone replacement, other bone replacement therapies. And these novel materials have an antimicrobial action. So in these cases, it's not needed to use antibiotics to treat these patients when they have these replacements with these materials. In addition, there are also many upcoming genetic technologies like CRISPR-Cas, but these are obviously mostly used to identify and to change bacteria. And this is a very technical story.
Our next episode will be more technical, as we will discuss some technologies and research more in depth than we do now. So let me briefly summarize what we have discussed thus far. We've spoken about the six professions and industries that are in one way or the other affected by AMR, and the five strategies how to fight and prevent it. AMR Insights is a Dutch initiative, and it's serving a global audience. And I would like to zoom out to a global scale, as AMR is an issue that crosses all national borders. Is there currently a global action plan, or are there global guidelines in curbing AMR? And are all stakeholders, so institutions and countries, including China being a key player, are they all involved in this?
When talking about antibiotic stewardship, in daily practice, it turns out that in the regulations are there in some countries. And there's no unity when you compare the different hospitals. It is sometimes on an ad hoc basis. There are in some cases, national guidelines. There are also some international guidelines and recommendations by the WHO. These guidelines also are being included in the international AMR, in the global AMR action plan, and as such also in the national AMR action plans. But in daily practice, these regulations are not always yet implemented, let it be that these are all strictly followed. And in order to implement these guidelines effectively, you need the involvement of many professionals. It's not only the medical doctors who should stick to the regulations, but also other professionals in these healthcare centers, in these nursing homes, in these hospitals, in these practices. And so in daily practices, it's only partly implemented. And there is certainly not yet a sort of unity in thinking and unity in working. Not at the national scale, let it be at an international scale.
So instead of a global action plan, we have several action plans at national levels. So let's shift our focus here to China. I ask about China because China is among the world's largest producers and consumers of antibiotics, which are mainly used for disease treatment in humans and livestock. And China is also hit hardest by antibiotic abuse and therefore bacterial resistance. However, to control AMR, the Chinese health administrative authorities have taken a series of actions over the past 10 years, including the development of a national action plan in 2016. Dr. Xiao, who's here as well to talk to us, has co-written this national strategy. Professor Xiao is Vice Director of the State Key Laboratory for Diagnosis and Treatment of Infectious Diseases at the College of Medicine of Zhejiang University, Hangzhou, China. Welcome, Professor Xiao. Thank you for being here. Would you please introduce yourself briefly?
I'm Dr. Yonghong Xiao from the Zhejiang University. I'm also a professor of infectious disease and worked in the first hospital of the Zhejiang University. And I worked as an infectious disease doctor for more than 30 years. And my major interest is antibiotic resistant. So during the past about 3 decades, I conducted some study, such as surveillance of resistant and also some study of the resistant mechanisms of the bacteria from the clinical settings. And also I did some workers to promote the rational use of antibiotic in healthcare settings, such as the hospital, some primary healthcare institution. So, I also conducted some education training for antibiotic management. So the major achievement during the past about 20 years, I participated in the draft of some regulation and orders issued by the Minister of Health, such as the clinical administration regulation for the antibiotic ration use. And also about 4 years ago, 2016, I drafted the National Action Plan to contain AMRs in China. So I think my major interest is AMR control in China, and also do some study and cooperation with the government. And also I have some international cooperation with some other countries such as the Netherlands, Sweden, and the Great Britain, and so on.
You are the only Chinese ambassador of the AMR Insights platform. Can you tell me why you joined as an ambassador? And can you also tell me to what extent the Chinese government stimulates international collaboration?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question because I know AMR is a global healthcare crisis. That means if we should contain AMRs, we should have a wide international cooperation. That means AMR, like infectious disease, the resistant bacteria can spread by the human beings' immigration or some communication and the transportation and so on. So if the human beings hope to get the victories over the control of AMR, we should take some international cooperation. Also, the international cooperation is encouraged by WHO. In 2015, the WHO also issued the Global Action Plan to contain AMRs. One of the major strategies is international cooperation. And at the same time, also in China, in the national education plans of China to contain AMRs, also the international cooperation was right in the education plan. So I think we should need more and more international cooperation in the future. And also sometimes AMR Insight is very, very interesting platforms to promote the international cooperation in AMR control. And you can find many, many ambassadors from different countries, different areas. You can find ambassadors from the Europe, from the American, from Africa, from Asia. It's true that at present stage, I'm the only one from China, but I think the ambassador have a task to promote the AMR control and also promote the international cooperation. And also I will make use of the AMR Insight platform to find more and more persons to join the AMR Insight from China.
So the AMR topic is included in China's national education plans. And these plans also cover the need for international collaboration. Can you tell me more about the main strategic points of this national action plan? And in which fields is international collaboration stimulated in China?
Yeah, I think that by the personally, I think many kinds of fields could be collaborated with other countries. For example, research and also education and training and some others. But I think the most important is that we should have some intellectual cooperation in the AMR surveillance, because we must get a panoramas image of the resistance around the world. So we should get international cooperation in AMR surveillance and get the information about the resistance situation in different area. And we could, by the AMR surveillance, we can find the spread of resistance between different areas. So after that, we can make some decision to taking some actions to control spread of resistance. I think that's one. Another end, by the international cooperation, we can share experience, because as you know, the education, the situation in different area, different country is some difference. For example, in the Netherlands, the antibiotic use is relatively lower compared with in China. So we can learn the experience of the Netherlands, how to decrease the antibiotic consumption in the hospital, in animal feedings and some other field. And also sometimes during the past 10 years, the China also taken very strict actions to control the irrational use of antibiotics in the hospitals. So you can find during the past 10 years, we got very, very, very successful achievement in the antibiotic decrease use in the hospital. So maybe our experience can be shared with other countries with similar healthcare systems. So I think the international cooperation is very important to share experience of different countries, different areas. Maybe everybody can learn something from other countries' experience, and also the successful stories can be implemented to some other country or other areas. I think the third very important is that we should have some cooperation in the innovation study of the control of AMR. As you know, at the various stages, almost we lost the last chance to have a very powerful antibiotic for the pan-drug-resistant bacteria such as the carbapenem-resistant antibacteriaceae. It's a very great challenge, not only to China, but some other countries also have these problems. So if we have some cooperation in the new drug or new technology development, maybe you can find some useful measures, drugs, or some other strategies to control the pan-drug-resistant bacteria. I think that's my personal idea about the very important international cooperation field.
So international collaboration on surveillance is key in your opinion. And you say that further collaboration on innovation, so the development of new drugs and new technologies, should be stimulated as well. It's interesting because for our next episode, we invited a Dutch researcher who's developing a test which can measure the level of antibiotics in our environment. And this test is accompanied with a data collection activity. And therefore, he's starting a data business in China to track the pollution levels in the environment. But so far for the next episode, back to the surveillance. How encompassing is China's current surveillance system?
Okay, yeah, to my knowledge, we have some surveillance system just for the healthcare system and also animal use of antibiotics. That means in agriculture and health ministers, you can find we have a both minister are running the surveillance system for the antibiotic consumption and also AMR in human beings and also in animals. But to my knowledge, I did not find any surveillance systems for the antibiotic pollution environment. So, but in fact, there are some studies, very small scale study about the antibiotic residue in the environment, in the river, in the lake, in the land, some and so on. So I think maybe in the future, we should have some surveillance system to track the antibiotic residue or the antibiotic resistant bacteria in the environment. I say it's a very important issue. And because, as you know, recent years, more and more environmental researchers is getting very interested to the control of AMR, especially in the environment. For example, in our university, there is research teams. They're very interested to involve the study of the AMR's genes environment. So I think maybe in the future, more and more researchers will be involved in the AMR of the environment. And at the same time, I think maybe the environment Austria will set up AMR surveillance and also antibiotic residue in the environment, I think.
Surveillance has improved over the last years, but environmental surveillance is not there yet. So China has seen vast economic growth over the last decades, which of course is great, but has also worsened the situation of AMR. Agriculture, for instance, agriculture has changed from traditional small-scale approach to a more intensive animal farming, which requires a lot of antibiotic use. But also, like I said before, nowadays China is the largest producer and user of antibiotics in the world. So there are many challenges China has to tackle. 2016 was a tipping point, as this was the year the National Action Plan was initiated. Could you tell me what China has done thus far?
Okay, as you know, the antibiotic consumption could be found in healthcare setting, also in animal feedings, and also essentially the same in our country. And about 10 years ago, the antibiotic consumption in the hospital is very high. So you can find that 10 years ago, the hospitalized patient to use antibiotic in about over 16%. That means more than 60% of the hospitalized patient to receive antibiotic treatment during the stay of the hospital. And from 2011, the Minister of Health of China take a very strict management about the antibiotic use in the hospital and setting some target for the hospital. That means that the hospital must meet with the target in a very short time, for example, 1 to 2, 3 years. So up to now, you can find the antibiotic consumption in the hospital have a very sharp decrease. You see, for example, the antibiotic use rate in hospitalized patients is 45% now. That means decreased from 70% to 47%. So it's a big decrease. And also you can find the outpatient use of antibiotic also have a very adverse decrease. So in the hospital, especially in the natural hospital, for example, secondary hospital and tertiary hospital, the antibiotic use is getting more and more reasonable. But it's true that in primary healthcare setting, for example, some city clinic or the countryside clinic can find antibiotic use have some problems. Maybe in the future, the Chinese government will take some action to control the irrational use in the primary healthcare setting. So I think in healthcare settings, the major strategies in China taken is the government administration. That means the government ask the hospital should do something, because in our countries, most of the hospital is a public hospital. That means over 80% of the natural hospital belong to the government. So the hospital always have a very good compliance with the order of the administrative authority. So I think you can find what's the reason why the hospital antibiotic consumption have a huge decrease during the past 10 years. Also at the same time, during the past several years, to my knowledge, the animal use of antibiotic also getting more and more strict control. During the about 2 or 3 years ago, the Minister of Agriculture also issued some regulation, for example, forbidding use of colistin as the growth promoters in animal feedings. So I think that's from good news. But in the rare situation and a very careful situation in the animal sectors is not so clear for me, because I'm not an agriculture expert. I'm just a doctor, so in clinic doctors. So I think in China, the experience to get success in antibiotic irrational control is the government's power. So I think the government have a very strong powers to get success in the irrational use of antibiotic use in both healthcare setting and also animal feed setting. After the decreased use of antibiotic, also you can find some resistant bacteria have strained to decrease gradually. Very special that the MRC, the methicillin resistant staphylococcus aureus, also decreased from 50% to about 35%, so during the past 10 years. So I think that's the story of the China during the past 10 years about the antibiotic use and also MR control.
What's the current status of development of new medication, alternative treatments, new technologies, etc.? And is there a specific goal?
Yes, true. If you're reading the National Education Plan to contain MRs issued in 2016, you can find the several purpose of the National Education Plan. One is the development of new antibiotic and alternative therapeutic strategies, which include, such as, for example, phages and also some protein drugs and so on. So you can find there is a target described in the National Catching Plan that means by the end of 2020, at least we should have two innovative drugs will be developed in China. To my knowledge, also the Chinese government have some science and development project managed by the Minister of Science Technologies. There's a new drug, a mega project of a new drug development, which includes some project for the new antibiotic development. I think that's the situation.
So two innovative drugs by the end of 2020, is that correct? By the end of this year? And is phage therapy one of these two to be developed treatments?
Yeah, I found some researchers, especially, for example, in Shanghai and some other cities, some researchers conducted the phage therapeutics for the pain drug resistant. For example, pain drug resistant Acinetobacter baumannii, also carbapenem resistant Enterobacteriaceae. But I think because phage is also a virus, the bacterial virus, we should have some basic research about the possible harms in Europe also conducted a phage therapy study. To my knowledge, maybe we should have some study in the primary preclinical stage, and then we should conduct some animal study, and then we can use the phage in the clinic. Maybe I think we should have a relatively longer way to go for getting the final use of the phage in the clinic.
In order to wrap up, what is the most promising solution for the problem? And what are the most important steps to take in your opinion?
I think, to my opinions and personal opinions, I think the Netherlands experience is a very successful experience, I think, because you can find in the Netherlands, the NMR is so bad, the resistance rate is very low. And at the same time, what's the reason make this result? The major reason is that the rational use of antibiotics. That means in the Netherlands, also some other Northern European countries, for example, Sweden and Denmark and some other countries, the antibiotic consumption is relatively small. So I think on one hand, we should promote the rational use of antibiotics, because the more antibiotic use, the higher resistance level. That means if we lowering the antibiotic consumption, that means the resistance level will be decreased. So I think it's a balance. It's very important. So I think any persons, including doctors, nurses, and general persons, can do its own jobs to promote the rational use of antibiotics. So I think antibiotic rational use should be the priority strategy to control AMRs. Because if we decrease antibiotic use, that means the bacteria can have a very, very less contact with antibiotics. The bacteria will not convert to resistant germs. So I think it's very good, same as in Netherlands experience. Of course, on the other hand, we should have some new technology, new drugs, or some new diagnosis technique. And also we should found some new alternative therapeutic method to treat the infections. So if we have some more strategies to manage the infection patients, that means antibiotic use will be decreased. And also the bacteria will suffer from different pre-use, so resistance will lessen and less. I think we should have two hands should be used.
Thank you, Professor Xiao. Thank you for your time. I would like to ask the same question to Maarten van Dongen of AMR Insights. Mr. van Dongen, we've discussed the five strategies how to combat AMR. In your opinion, which is the most important strategy, or which one is the most promising or has the highest payoff?
Prevention has, according to my gut feeling, the highest payoff. I think if by preventing infectious diseases, we would be able to avoid that many millions of people around the globe become diseased, get an infectious disease. And if we can prevent this, these patients do not need antibiotics. and do not desire treatment at all. So these patients do not deal with resistant bacteria. But it is certainly not enough to focus only on preventing infectious diseases. So I think that by combining efforts and focusing on all the five key strategies, preventing antibiotic stewardship, better diagnostics, novel antibiotics, and better and novel alternatives for antibiotics, I think only by jointly picking up all these key strategies, we may be able to diminish the threats which are being offered by antimicrobial resistance.
AMR Insights is a unique platform, as we discussed before, but also partly because of its ambassador network, which is a broad network that is growing organically around the world. My question is, who are these ambassadors and how can you become one?
Yeah, the AMR Insights Ambassador Network was started last year in September because we realized that while many professionals around the globe are involved in curbing AMR, they include what I said before, medical doctors, veterinarians, epidemiologists, entrepreneurs, journalists, professors, scientists, working in public and private organizations around the globe. And we decided to start this network because we needed input from people who were really working in the front lines, so to say the boots on the ground. So we really anticipate and we welcome their input. And at the same time, we also realized that as AMR Insight, we wanted to have more output via these ambassadors. So these ambassadors also play a role in spreading the information we provide in the networks of their networks. So in fact, these ambassadors are the capillaries of AMR Insights, the lungs, so to say. So far, we have now some 170 ambassadors in almost 50 countries around the globe. We have set the goal to have at least one ambassador in each of the countries of the world by the end of this year. So this means in all the 180 countries we have. In principle, everyone who is involved in curbing AMR and who is interested to join is welcomed at the network. I mean, there is a simple form you have to complete. It's online available on the AMR Insights information platform, and by completing the form, you can enter the network. We welcome professionals who are involved. We welcome especially those professionals who are really motivated and also inspired to add to the global curbing of AMR. And we have big ambitions for the network. We recently started to set up a board for this network with five people in this board from the contest, and we are working on the strategic plans for this network. We are working on setting our goals and how also we want to develop in an important voice when it comes to curbing antimicrobial resistance at a global scale.
Thank you, Dr. Maarten van Dongen, and also thank you, Dr. Yonghong Xiao, for taking the time to share your knowledge and insights on how to tackle the problem of antimicrobial resistance. If you would like to know more about the topic, please visit Maarten van Dongen's global information platform, www.amr-insights.eu. If you are a professional in one of the fields that were mentioned at the beginning of the episode, then you might want to connect to the platform to pass on and gain insights and share knowledge with others. Please feel free to share this episode and help spread awareness. If you want more information on the speakers, please visit our website, netherlandsinnovation.nl. Here you can also leave a comment. If you would like to reach us, our email is china@netherlandsinnovation.nl. Our next episode will also be devoted to this topic, but then we'll go more in depth. We'll be talking about the importance of tracking antibiotic pollution in our environment and about current fundamental research and how it might offer solutions for the future. The next episode will be published in 2 weeks, and we'll hope you'll be tuning in again. Thanks for listening.